Hello, ladies. How is everyone this evening? You look beautiful. I got to meet so many of you out into the lobby, and we are so happy here. I know you're still finding your seats. We had to get everyone off the dance floor already. You ladies, like, it's time for church, and you guys are still out on the dance floor. Okay, so my name is Sarah Ridgway, and I have the privilege and honor of serving all of our ladies of Lakewood. If you are a Lakewood woman, this is your home. Let me hear you tonight. Yes. Just yes. Well, I also want to acknowledge if you are visiting us tonight, if this is your first time maybe at Lakewood, let me hear from you. Where are you, ladies? Excellent. Well, on behalf of Pastor Victoria Osteen and the women of Lakewood, we just want to welcome you tonight. We are truly honored that you decided to come. I'm going to be quick as we have worship going, but ladies, our theme this year is Forever Loved. Main thing I want from you and our hearts from our team want for you is that you walk out of here tonight and that you know that you are forever loved. There's nothing you can do to make God love you anymore. And there's nothing you can do to make him love you any less. Amen? I'm thankful for that. Because some days I'm not so pretty. Some days I don't always put my best foot forward, but I'm thankful that he's there. The Bible says in Romans 8:38 that nothing can separate us from his love. Absolutely nothing. How many of you received that tonight? Well, before we get going, I want you to repeat after me. I have never lived a day of my life unloved. Say that. So on those days when you wake up and you're just not sure about things, remind yourself, I have never lived an unloved day in my life. You may not feel loved, you may have some things done to you, but God loves you. You have never lived one day unloved by him. Amen? All right, well, ladies, we want to take this time and begin to worship our Creator, worship the One, and thank the One who loves us immeasurably. So let's get to worship.
Hope and grace fills the sky.
So you might be in a public place and you hear someone call mom, but you've learned to tune it out because there's a lot of moms out there. But if I hear Lorna, that's personal. Somebody knows me, somebody's calling me. And so I pay attention. And in the New Testament, when God's name was revealed, it was a name that was personal. Something that we could use, something that we could call on. And there might be a time you're on the road and someone swerves into your lane and you yell out the name of Jesus and he's right there. Amen. And there might be other times where all you can do is just whisper his name and he is just as close in that moment. So tonight, I don't know what you're going through. I don't know if you feel like calling out in a loud voice the name of Jesus, or maybe you're under a lot of weight right now and all you feel like you can do is just whisper it. But I promise you that when you speak the name of Jesus, the atmosphere changes. It's personal. He's listening. And his name is beautiful, wonderful, and powerful. Now we
heart and every mind. Cause I know there is peace within your presence. It has been Jesus. Yeah. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break. Ooh. When there is hope and there is freedom, I speak Jesus. Oh, your name is power, your name is healing, and your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn light.
Trouble. that you said you would never leave us or forsake us. And we are here to honor you, Jesus. We're here to glorify the name of Jesus. We thank you, Father, for bringing every person here tonight. Lord, you know exactly who they are, whether they're in the house or watching online. Father, you know their name. You know the very hair on their heads. You know everything that concerns them because they are your chosen vessel. So, Father, I lift up every woman in this place, every woman at the sound of my voice, and we say together, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Thank you. Thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do in this place, what you've already begun. And Father, you said when you begin a good work, you will finish it. You will complete it. So Father, I thank you that we are walking towards completion in every area of our life. Father, we thank you for this evening. We bless every person here. We bless the speakers, Father, as they share their heart. And Father, we want to thank you personally that you brought us here together, powerful in one mind and one accord. And Father, in the book of Acts, when they stood in one mind and one accord, a mighty rushing wind blew in. So Father, I thank you that the Spirit of the Lord is rushing into every situation, rushing into every obstacle and every life. Thank you, Father, that your Spirit is alive and well and living on the inside of us. And it's in that precious name of Jesus. And everyone said, Amen. You may be seated. My goodness, I don't think I've been in such a powerful place than I am tonight, right here. There is nothing like a bunch of on fire, Holy Ghost filled women in one room praising God. You guys are amazing, and we are so grateful that you came tonight. We love each and every one of you, and our theme kind of tonight is forever loved. And I want you to know, like Sarah said, you are forever loved. There was never a time in your life that you were not loved by the Father in heaven. So we sit in a place tonight of being loved. Doesn't matter how we feel. Doesn't matter how our day went. Doesn't matter what we're up against right now. We are loved by the Creator of the universe. And we have to find peace in that love, because in that love is where peace lives. So tonight, I am so grateful that you're here. And I just want to remind you, because there's a lot of people in this room. My goodness, all of us together are powerful. I want to remind you, I feel like God just brought this scripture up to my heart and mind in Isaiah 43. He says, Behold, I am doing a new thing. I'm doing a new thing. God's doing a new thing in you right now. How many of you can perceive that new thing? Amen. Father, we perceive it. We believe it. We know, God, that change is taking place. That things are breaking loose in the supernatural for our favor. Amen. God is so good. We got to perceive it every day. We got to look for it. Can't look at the situation, can't look at the circumstance, but we got to turn our eyes to the name we've been speaking tonight, Jesus. 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 And as we do that, I believe we will see him do amazing things in our life. Amen. All right, well, I'm excited tonight. We have two amazing women in the house. Woo! Friend of mine, Jamie Kern, I met her about 7 years ago. She's an amazing woman. She founded It Cosmetics. Many of you use that product. Many of you are familiar with it if you've been in Ulta or Sephora or around. But anyway, so she's gonna be up first, and she's gonna speak a message to us. So take a look at this video right now.
It's interesting how life works out when you don't let no stop you.
Jamie Kern Lima is her name. She landed on Forbes' list of America's richest self-made women. Go, Jamie.
Jamie Kern Lima.
Our next guest sold the cosmetics company that she created in her living room to L'Oreal for $1.2 billion, becoming the first female CEO for that company in over 100 years.
My friend Jamie Kern, the founder of IT Cosmetics, became a huge success. She was on QVC 200 times a year.
Believe it. Believe it.
Believe It, which just celebrated its seventh week on the New York Times bestseller list.
Well, your book is amazing.
You are a genius.
You're just pure vibrancy and vitality for life, I think, is infectious.
You know that I would only do this with you. It's my favorite interview ever that's ever been on my show. I usually get other people crying on my show. You actually got me crying on my own show today, so.
There's not a more sincere human being that I've met. There's this desire to serve that is so sincere it can't be faked. And there's a level of persistence and a level of caring and a level of love in this human being that has made her who she is, who has such a living example of what her book's about.
You have been brave and you showed up and you made a difference, and thank you. Jamie Kern Lima.
Lakewood! Hello! I love you! Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you so much. I am so, honestly, I'm so emotional being here. For one, when I see that story, I know that's not my story. I know that's his story. That's what I know for sure. Also, there's so much more when I think about being here right now with each one of you. I think there's now over 13,000 of us right now live together. 13,000 women. Like, I was backstage with Sarah Jakes Roberts, who literally almost had me crying my makeup off. But that's another story. And I just couldn't help but think of the power in this room, the dreams in this room, the callings and the anointing in this room, right? And you know, the highlight reels or you know, the story that the press loves to share. By the way, the mic just went out, so now I have a handheld, but we're good. The story the press loves to share is, you know, Denny's waitress builds billion-dollar company. That's kind of the story everywhere. And while that's true, when I'm here with you tonight live, I'm really emotional for a couple of reasons. One is that I see that video and I know that video and the things in that video almost didn't happen. They almost didn't happen. And when I stand here right now, I think of the countless times, and I'm talking about countless times, I was sitting in my living room watching Joel and Victoria on TV long years before I met them. Literally, I'd rewatch the sermon Joel did called Your Life is Divinely Orchestrated. And I'd watch it over and over and over because I was sitting there with no money, with hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of rejections, with so much self-doubt, right? And I sat there in this long season of my life where literally every day my biggest goal was like, okay, how do I turn down the volume on my own self-doubt and turn up the volume on what God says about me and my life, right? And that was the real story. And so in honor of the short time we have together, I'm not here to share the highlight reel. I've been praying about this all day, and I just feel called to come out here and share like the real stories behind the stories, right? The ones that you don't see online, that my hope and prayer is maybe help you feel less alone in your struggles you might be going through and more enough in your pursuit of the God-sized dreams that you have on your heart right now. So if you're good with that, that's what I'm gonna go spend the next 2 minutes going right into. You know, my story I thought was gonna be very different. I don't know if you've had this experience, but from the time I was a little girl,
Like, I thought I knew what I was gonna do. I would watch Oprah in my living room every day, which makes that a whole other thing that I can't process yet. I'd watch her in my living room every day, and I'm like, one day I'm gonna grow up and share other people's stories with the world and do a talk show. So I thought my whole life that's what I was gonna do. And so I did all the jobs, right, to try and pay my way through school. And, you know, I was pushing grocery carts in the grocery store and bagging groceries and slicing meat in the deli and waitressing at Denny's and selling popcorn at the swap meet and all the jobs to eventually land in my dream job. And fast forward to 2007, I was anchoring the news in Portland, Oregon, and I thought, like, this is it. I'm going to be here, you know, forever. I've made it. And what I didn't know was I was about to enter this massive season of setback in my life and self-doubt in my life. And, you know, I had a hereditary skin condition, I still do, called rosacea. For me, it gets really red all over my face, bumpy, like almost like welts. And I knew I had it. I had seen all the dermatologists. There's no cure for it. But I always just had the approach, oh, I'll just cover it with makeup, it'll be good. And one day I was live on the air, anchoring the news, and you're live, and I hear in my earpiece from the producer, there's something on your face, there's something on your face, you need to wipe it off, you need to wipe it off. And so I was like, okay, okay. And I kept going, you know, because you can't respond. You're supposed to be in the moment with the viewer. And at the commercial break, I glanced down and I saw what it was. The makeup was breaking up. And if you imagine like a desert of clay cracking and like red coming through. And so I tried to cover it. I tried to cover it. Went back on the air and it kept going. He's like, it's still there. It's still there. It's still there. And I just remember, like, you know, entering this big season of self-doubt where I started trying every product out there, right? I'd use my paycheck to buy all the stuff out there from the department stores to the drug stores, and nothing would work. And, you know, I was in a really tough spot because live on the air, right? I don't know if you guys have ever felt imposter syndrome or just so much self-doubt, but I'd be live on the air, you know, supposed to be connecting with viewers and sharing the news. And in my head, I'd be thinking thoughts like, am I gonna get fired? Are viewers changing the station right now, right? Like, am I costing the station ratings? And it was a season of setback, but as Joel Osteen loves to say, sometimes our greatest setbacks, right, are actually God's setups for what we're actually called to do next. We just don't see it at the time. We just don't see it at the time, right? So I'm sitting there and I remember this moment, you guys, where I got this feeling where I was like, well, wait a minute. What if nothing works for me, right? There's thousands of makeup companies. If nothing works for me, there's probably other people that nothing works for them. What if I could create a product, like figure out how to create something, it could help a whole lot of other people. So I had that idea, right? If you ever had like a still small voice give you like a idea or a nudge for something, I see a lot of you nodding right now. I had that idea, but then what happens? That's my gut, that's my knowing, right? Instantly my head talked me right out of it. It's like, oh, but you got no money, and you got no connections, and you know no one in the beauty industry. So I sat in that space for a long time of having that gut, that knowing, that inkling, and then my head talking me out of it, right? And one day, what happened to me that I consider pure grace, right? You hear probably a lot of thought leaders talk about knowing your why for your goal or your why for your business or your why for your dream. I had this big, like, why drop on me, and it was that I realized, like, this makes no sense. How is there thousands of companies and none of them work for me? Then I realized, well, wait a minute. Like, I've never seen a woman with rosacea going, here's a product, like selling it, right? This was 2007. Everything was Photoshopped, airbrushed, all of that. And then I realized, since the time I was a little girl, and maybe a lot of you can relate to this, I would see those beauty commercials on television or in magazines, and I loved them. Like, I would watch them, and I'd aspire to look that way. But deep down inside, they always made me feel like I wasn't enough. And I had this moment where I'm like, wait a minute. Like, okay, maybe I could figure out how to create a product, but what if What if I'm supposed to actually create that product and then use real people as models, like every age and shape and size and skin tone and skin challenge and call them beautiful and mean it? And what if I could do something to try to shift that definition of beauty in the entire beauty industry for every little girl out there who's about to start doubting herself and every grown woman who still does? Right, so I had this like God-sized kind of dream all of a sudden, but I didn't know how it was gonna happen, right? But that meaning and how much it meant to me was really what put me over the edge, and I made the decision to turn down the volume on my self-doubt in that moment and on the thoughts that said, you're not qualified, you don't have what it takes, how are you gonna figure this out, there's too much against you. And I just started to trust, right, to trust that knowing. And in 2007, on my honeymoon flight to South Africa, did the least romantic thing you can ever do and wrote a business plan and got back from South Africa, quit my job. My husband quit his job. We went all in. We had very little savings, y'all, but we poured every penny into just trusting this feeling, this knowing. And we poured all of our money into a product. We worked with chemists and third-party manufacturers, and we created a product that worked for me. And I was like, this is gonna be huge. Like, I just knew it, right? Like, you know when you know? And I knew it. And then I also learned that's not enough often, right? We had spent most of our money, and I had sent all of the products out to all the beauty stores, right? All the beauty stores, the department stores. Every single one of them said no. And it was no after no after no. So many times when I finally got them on the phone, because I would, you know, show my own rosacea and show how it works, and I would use real people as models. And they'd always tell me the same thing. They would say, women will not buy makeup from images like that. They'd always say, you need unattainable aspiration. That's what the words they'd always use, meaning like, something you can never actually even look like. And I'm like, okay, I get it's always been done that way, but maybe women are tired of buying from images that don't look like them. You know what I mean? But here's the thing, right? It was still no after no after no after no. And this went on for a very long time, and we got down to almost no money. And so I'm like, all right, everyone's saying no. Right? And by the way, y'all, I used to save my Denny's tip money to like buy one product in Sephora, right? So I thought like, oh, they're gonna love this, you know, all the things. Everyone said no, and this went on for years. It would be 3 years before I could even afford to pay myself. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of no's. And I was like, all right, we're gonna go direct to consumer. That's what we're gonna do. Like, they just don't get it. Like, I kept having this feeling, no matter all the no's, we're supposed to keep going. So I was like, okay, we're gonna go direct to consumer. So, but we couldn't afford to hire anyone to build our website, right? Any of y'all that have like launched a dream in your living room, it's hard. Yeah, I see a lot of you raising your hand. You gotta figure out how to do all the jobs you don't know how to do, especially if you're like me and you can't afford to pay anyone to do them, right? So I'm like, okay, so we couldn't afford to hire anyone to build our website. So my husband went and bought that big yellow book, HTML for Dummies. And he literally designed our first website. And you guys, like, I was so excited. So the day it went live, I was like a kid on Christmas morning. Our website went live. I was freaking out, like pacing our office, which is our living room, and just like so excited. And the entire day, no orders. The next day, no orders. The entire week went by, no orders. And what I did, if any of y'all have launched a business or a dream or a goal with your partner or a friend or a loved one, I did what's so easy to do. I said to him, it's broken. You did it wrong. Like, you built you built the website wrong. There's no way, like, a product this good is there and no one's just buying it. Like, it's broken. The weeks went on and no orders. And the day our very first order ever came in, I was freaking out, like literally running around our living room, like screaming. My husband's from Brazil, and when they score a soccer goal, he yells so loud that our dogs hide under the bed. And that was me. Like, I was like, we got our first order, like running around. And he comes up to me and he goes, that was me. He goes, I placed the order to prove to you it's not broken. And I was just like, oh. And we kept going and going and going. I remember getting this huge call from Sephora, and I was like, oh my gosh. And I remember flying up there. I could barely afford the ticket to San Francisco, and it was one of the most painful no's I'd ever gotten. I'll cut the story very short, but I left the building literally sobbing. And then one day, I finally got a call from QVC. And how many of you guys have heard of QVC or you know of QVC? Okay, it's a 24/7 live television shopping channel. And I just had this vision. I'm like, okay, like, you couldn't Photoshop live TV. Let me get on there and then I'll prove the product works. Like, let me prove it. And I just had this vision for it. But I'd been sending them products for 3 years and it was no after no after no after no. Finally, their head guy, a guy named Alan Burke, right? He's like this legend in the beauty industry. You know how there's Anna Wintour in fashion? And Alan Burke is this legend, and he is responsible for building this multi-billion dollar beauty division on QVC. And he was the one that wanted to do the call. And I was like, so I remember like doing all the power posing, I don't know, in our living room before the call. And I was like, they'll be lucky to have us. Like, they'll be so lucky to get IT Cosmetics, all the things. And then when the phone rang, he's like, you know, Jamie, this is Alan Burke with QVC. I'm like, Alan, you know, so great to meet you. And he says, you know, we've received your products, all of them, because I had been sending for years. And he goes, I really want to tell you directly. We've met with the buyers, and it's unanimous. It's a no. You're not the right fit for QVC or for our customers. And I was like, I remember tears just streaming down my face. Y'all, we were down to under $1,000 in our bank account, which meant we just had a couple of weeks left before we went bankrupt, right? And I was just like, tears are streaming down. I'm like, oh, but Alan, I am the right fit. And I told him all the reasons why. And he thanked me for loving QVC and said it's a no. And I remember that day climbing under my covers, right? Because how many times do we just feel like something's supposed to be? Like, we have that knowing, that feeling, that still small voice. But then everything around us is telling us it's wrong, right? And I was like, God, I do not understand why that you are. I feel like you are telling me to keep going, but everybody is saying no. And not no for now, but like no, no, right? And when someone tells you you're not the right fit, right? I mean, it's layered, right? And I just remember getting under my covers and crying myself to sleep. I remember waking up the next morning hoping it was a dream and then realizing it wasn't, and reliving it. And, you know, because there's over 13,000 of us women together live right now, I just want to share one moment from under the covers. And that was, I remember writing in my journal, I remember praying, and every time, I kept thinking I was still wrong, but every time I'd get still and I would pray for an answer, I got this feeling I was supposed to keep going. You know what I mean? But it didn't make sense in my head. Right? And I had, and maybe some of y'all will relate to this, some of y'all who are going after your dream right now, but I had so many friends and family who love me, and they're like, wait, you still haven't made any money? Wait, you still, right? And they're like thinking you're crazy. I'm just like trying to trust that. And I remember writing in my journal, know your why, then fly, girl, fly. And I remember reading that every single day until I didn't need the reminder anymore. And I just kept going and kept going. And I got a call that would change my life. So we got contacted by this potential investor, huge, famous private equity company that had gotten hold of our product. And they're really well known for taking like these small, unknown pre-revenue product brands and turning them into these big companies that we all buy in grocery stores and big box retailers and department stores. And they got a hold of our product, and I'm like, oh my gosh. And they wanted to do a meeting. And I'm like, this is huge, because if they invest in us, A, I'm not gonna go bankrupt. And B, like, what if they could use their leverage to get us into these stores that keep telling me no? So I'm like, okay. So we started doing meeting after meeting after meeting, and we got to the final phase, which was the diligence phase, right? They look at all your projections. And I remember my husband and I flew up for the final meeting, and we had presented our whole product pipeline for the future and all these things. And it came to the end of the meeting, and the head guy was about 3 feet from me, and his whole team was there, and they were really lovely. And this is like literally the moment where I was like, okay, like it's gonna change my life, right? And he says, congratulations on your product. It's really, really a great product, but it's a no. We're gonna pass on investing in It Cosmetics. And I was like, okay, because at this point I'd heard no so many times, right? And I said, can you tell me why? Because feedback is usually a gift, right? And I'm like, can you tell me why? And he got really quiet for a long time. And he's literally 3 feet from me, and my husband's right here. And he just paused, and he says, do you want me to be really honest with you? And I'm like, yes, please. And he says to me, he is right here, and he says, I just don't think women will buy makeup from someone who looks like you with your body and your weight. And I remember in that moment, well, first of all, it was like literally a lifetime of body doubt and self-doubt like flooded my body all at once. And I never actually felt any anger toward him at all. I literally just felt like I was staring my own fear and insecurities and doubts like straight in the eye, right? But one thing happened in that moment that I want to share with you, right? Because every single one of us has had someone doubt us or say things that hurt us or look us in the eye and in their own way tell us we're not enough, right? And so many times we're the ones telling ourselves those things, right? And in that moment, y'all, something happened I will never forget for the rest of my life. When he was right here, like 3 feet from me, and he says, I just don't think women will buy makeup from someone who looks like you with your body and your weight. I got this feeling right here so strong that said, he's wrong. Like, he's wrong. Like, I felt it, right? I felt it. I didn't know how I was gonna prove it, but I felt it, right? Like literally like it was yesterday. It was that still small voice or that knowing that said he's wrong. I felt it so, so, so strong, right? And when I look back at this moment, what I know happened in that moment was like he gave me a no, but he gave me a knowing, right? And how many times, whether it's you telling yourself no, or she or her telling you no, or them telling you no, or the marketplace is telling you no, or whatever's happening, right? The publisher, the book editor, whoever is telling you no, right? You post something online, you're getting no likes, you feel like everyone's telling you no, but when you get still, he will always give you a knowing, right? And I believe your life, your family, your dreams, your business, your goals, your anointing, your calling comes down to which one you listen to. Do you listen to the no, or do you listen to the knowing, right? And literally in that moment, because here's the deal, y'all, every one of us, right? I feel like self-doubt kills more dreams than anything else. Self-doubt kills more dreams than anything else, right? And when I was praying earlier today, and really just asking God for what am I supposed to share, the thing that kept coming to me today is how many women, including myself most of my life, doubt ourselves out of our own destiny. How many of us actually never become the person we're born to be, right? Because we're trusting our own doubt instead of trusting him, right? When he says you're perfectly and wonderfully made, when he says I've equipped you with everything you need, and then we doubt it, who are we doubting? Is it really self-doubt, or are we doubting him? You see what I'm saying? And when I think back of like, how did this story happen? Wasn't me, but it was the moments I decided to turn down the volume on me, right? And turn up the volume on him. And like, So many of us, right? So many of us, we get knocked down or we get a no and we give up after one no or five no's or 10 no's, right? And we want to give up, but like, I don't know if I can quote Jay-Z at Lakewood Church, but Jay-Z says the genius thing we did was we didn't give up. Right? And sometimes that's what it comes down to. When you have that knowing, you're supposed to keep going and you make the decision to trust it, right? When you get knocked down, those are not the times you give up. Those are the times you tune into the knowing. You say, God, am I supposed to be on this track? Let me trust you, right? And even when it doesn't make sense at the time, with God and grace and grit, you get back up and you keep going. And that's what we did. Somehow. And we kept going and going, and I'm going to cut a very long story very short, but I was at a big beauty expo, and QVC had this giant booth, right? There were 6,000 women there in New York. They had this giant booth. I was demonstrating my product, and I just literally made a beeline straight up for the buyer of QVC, and I'd never met anyone in person, and she knew who I was right away. But I was like, oh, hi, I'm Jamie from It Cosmetics, and literally like poured my heart out. And long story short, she invited me for a meeting. I flew out to Westchester, Pennsylvania, and we got our very first yes, right? But here's what it meant. Here's what that yes meant, I would soon learn. It meant we got one shot. We got one shot, right? A 10-minute segment live on QVC. We'd have to pay for all the inventory to sell. We wouldn't get paid for anything unless it sold. So we somehow had to get the money to pay for everything to get there. And now we were doing about 2 to 3 orders a day on our website. That did work at the time. And I learned we'd have to ship in 6,000 units of our product to sell in 10 minutes to hit their sales goal or not come back. At this point, you should never, business owners know, you should never accept a purchase order you cannot afford to lose. But at this point, it was like we had no's for years, no other option. We prayed about it, decided to go for it. We applied for an SBA loan. 22 banks said no. The 23rd bank, California Bank and Trust, I don't know what they were thinking, but they said yes. And they gave us an SBA loan that covered the cost of the one airing purchase order and a little bit extra. So we were now manufacturing 6,000 units of this product. Everything was on the line. And we hired these third-party consultants, okay, that help you kind of produce your sell, your presentation. And they help a lot of people sell their products in stores and on television. And they're amazing, right? And we met with them, except here's the thing. They all told me the same thing. They said, if you want a shot at succeeding, at hitting those numbers, here's what you need to do. You need to use this type of model to demonstrate your product, all like perfect skin, look like they're 12, same skin tone, right? And I'm just like, okay, thank you, but you know, here's like why we're doing this, you know? And I say, well, what if I put women of every age and shape and size, like a model in her, you know, 70s or 80s, and then, you know, another model who struggles with acne, and then I'll take my makeup off and show my rosacea. And they were mortified, like literally mortified. And here's the thing, they wanted me to win. They wanted me to win, right? And y'all, I was so stressed out that I flew out to QVC a week before our one big shot. And I sat in the parking lot in a rental car all alone, like staring at the front door, praying, crying. I sang I Surrender All and asked God to take me because I heard Oprah did that once. I was like, I was doing it, all of it. And I had so many moments in that car of self-doubt where I was like, okay, well maybe, like I know you can't fake authenticity. I know in my spirit that while authenticity alone does not automatically guarantee success, inauthenticity guarantees failure in any area of life. I know that. And still I sat in that car, right? And all of a sudden I had thoughts like, well, if I try it their way, and then I make some money, and it works, then I can try it my way, right? I started trying to talk myself into like, because it was a long road. And I had this moment where I thought about, who is that woman watching me? And in that car that day, I'll never forget, for whatever reason, I imagine like, who's going to be turning on the TV? They broadcast live to 100 million homes. But for whatever reason, I imagine this single mom in Nebraska folding laundry, like way too busy to remember she's beautiful and that she matters. And I had this moment where I imagine, like, if she's going to turn on her television and give me 2 seconds of her precious time, I would rather her look up and see women who look like her, hear me calling them beautiful and meaning it, even if she buys nothing, right, than sell a whole bunch of product and stand for nothing. But sometimes when we know what to do is not the easy thing to do, you know? And I remember walking into the studio for my one shot, and I walked in, and there's these 3 cameras set up, and there's a big clock on the bottom, and it was set to 10 minutes. And then I learned, oh, you're not guaranteed the 10 minutes. If you go live on the air, and if you're not hitting sales numbers, they know by the second. And if you're not hitting them, you might still think you have 8 minutes left. Uh-uh. They cut, your clock jumps down to 1 minute, and you're done, right? And I was like, oh my gosh. And so I had to get out of my head, because I was thinking about every single thing that was on the line in that moment, right? And I had that feeling, that knowing that I was supposed to do it authentically, even though everything else and everyone else around me was telling me to do it a different way. I wore double Spanx that day. Not because of how I looked, but I was sweating so much that I wanted to absorb the sweat and not have it go through my dress on national television. I remember the moment that the clock went live, and the host, who was amazing, was there, and I was trying to do this demonstration on my wrist that shows how our product doesn't crease and the other ones do. And I was trying to do it. I'd practiced in my bathroom mirror a million times, but now I had the weight of all of this on my shoulders. And it was like this, and I was like, and I was trying to talk, and I was freaking out, and she shoved my hand under the podium, and she's like, thank you, sugar, and she took over. And I remember I was live, and I remember the moment my bright red bare face before shot came up on national television. I remember walking over to the models, every age, shape, skin tone, size, skin challenge, calling them beautiful, meaning it. And I didn't know how it was going. We were like 8 minutes in, but I knew I wasn't cut yet. And then it got down to the minute, like 1 minute left, and I heard the host say, the deep shade is almost gone. The tan shade is about to sell. And I'm like, ooh. And then literally, at the 10-minute mark, this giant sold-out sign came up across the screen. And I was like, right? I start crying on national TV. They cut from me and go to like Dyson vacuum or something. And my husband comes rushing through the double doors of the studio, and I'm like, real women have spoken. And I'm like, stop. And I thought he was like gonna give me a hug, and he's like, we're not going bankrupt. And I was like, ah! And that one airing turned into 5 more that year, and then 101 the next year, and then 250 live shows a year, every single year after that. Y'all, we built the biggest beauty brand in QVC's history. And it is right now. It is right now to this day. And I only share that because it was years of them saying no, of Alan Burke saying not only no, but you're not the right fit for us or for our customers, right? And after this happened, we then got a yes from Sephora and from Ulta and from all the department stores. Some of them took 6 more years, but every single no eventually turned into a yes. And here's the crazy thing, y'all. You remember Alan Burke, right? The head of QVC who said, you're not right for us or our customers. After we launched on QVC, he became a dear friend, one of my greatest mentors. He still is to this day. He was so, I guess, just passionate about how we stuck with our authentic vision. And he retired after decades of being at QVC. He retired, and we hired him. We hired him in a paid position on our advisory board. So the man that rejected me was now working for me. What? What?
I don't know. I don't know who needs to hear this today, but no one can tell you you're not the right fit. No one can tell you you're not the right fit, right? And by the way, one thing that occurred to me after that was like, oh my gosh, the guy that called me rejected is now calling me boss. What? No one can tell you how big your God-sized dreams can be. Even in the years while you're having them and they feel like they're not working out, right? Even when it feels like opposition is against you, when it feels like, in my case, so many experts I'd put on a pedestal, right? Right? Were telling me no, right? So it was like a big journey, and we grew and grew and grew, and I'm like, okay, how do we take this vision for beauty global, right? How can we scale it globally? And I quickly realized, oh, that's hard. And I could do it. We started launching other countries, but I knew if I did it on my own, it would be at a slower pace. And so I was like, okay, I got that knowing again, like, what if we partner with L'Oreal or a company like that who has like teams on the ground in 100 countries, and we could instantly scale this and impact more people more quickly. And so I started taking meetings with L'Oreal, and they ended in a no for years, right? I was like, oh, if we partner, all these things. They said no for years. A lot of people don't know this. L'Oreal said no for years until they didn't. And they made this huge, crazy, insane offer to buy It Cosmetics. And the way God orchestrates things, right? Going back to Joel's sermon, I watched a million times on how our lives are divinely orchestrated, not just in the good times, but also in the bad times, right? As God orchestrates things, when L'Oreal finally made this huge offer, I could have never imagined the days I was waitressing tables. I could have never imagined something like that. But when they did that, so did a bunch of other companies with bigger offers. And so most people don't know this part of the story, but I then said no to L'Oreal, which was crazy. Like, I knew how to hear no, but I didn't know how to say no, right? And then they came back with a way bigger offer, and we said yes. It felt more than fair. And in 2016, this idea, this God-sized dream in my living room, they paid $1.2 billion cash for it, and they made me the first woman to hold a CEO title in their 100-year history. And here's the thing, y'all. The day they announced this, they're a big public company, so they have to announce all of everything, the purchase price, everything. The day they announced it was like the homepage of the Wall Street Journal online, it was everywhere, was the first time in 6 years I heard from that investor. The one that said, women won't buy makeup from someone who looks like you with your body and your weight. He's a huge private equity company. So he reached out and he said, first time in 6 years I'd heard from him. And he said, congratulations on the L'Oreal deal. I was wrong. That's what he said. And... y'all know that moment in the movie Pretty Woman where the store, like, they won't help her? So what I wanted to say to him in that moment, big mistake. Huge. Huge. Like the human part of me wanted to say, I can give you 1.2 billion reasons why it was a huge mistake. But I didn't. I thanked him. I thanked him, and I remembered one thing in that moment that maybe someone needs to remember right now. I, to this day, am now fearless about rejection, and I get it all the time. I get it every day. And when I get rejected, I instantly go, rejection is God's protection. Every time. And by the way, I say that in friendships. If a friend hurts me or disappears or any type of relationship or any, like, these moments happen to us all the time. Y'all, when I wanted him to invest so desperately, I would have given him the majority of the company for probably nothing because I didn't know what we were gonna do. But because he didn't believe in me, because he rejected me, the day L'Oreal bought our company, I was the largest shareholder. Like,
thank God he didn't believe in me. Do you see what I'm saying? And I didn't learn for 6 years why God had him not believe in me, right? But rejection is God's protection. And you know, here's the thing. It has been a wild journey. In the first 2 years, I gave L'Oreal my word, I would stay 3 years. And in the first 2 years post-acquisition, we doubled the size of the business. The company is now in so many countries. And I got this knowing about 3 years in that I was supposed to use everything I had been through to serve in a whole other way. So I wrote my first ever book, Believe It, and donating 100% of the proceeds from that. It's all about like, how do you go from underestimated to unstoppable? And now I'm putting leadership training into hundreds of prisons and doing all kinds of stuff that I'm so passionate about and grateful for. But when I think about how the story almost didn't happen, why I wanted to share some of the things I shared is because I believe every one of us is connected. I believe everyone is here right now. Oprah always says to me, there's no coincidences. She always says that, right? And I don't know who needed to hear this story today or who needed to be reminded to turn down the volume on your own self-doubt and turn up the volume on what he says about you and on your knowing. Because so many people say to me like, how did you start with close to nothing and build a billion-dollar company, right, from your living room? And it's like, yeah, I worked really, really hard, and I got back up every time I got knocked down. And I built a team of over 1,000 employees eventually, right, from that HTML for Dummies book to over 1,000 employees who are way smarter than I am, right? And I learned it to trust my knowing over all the no's. But really, when I think about it, right, how did I build a billion-dollar business from my living room? Like, I made the decision to trust him, right, over myself. And I made the decision in trusting him to believe that I could. And my hope and prayer is that one woman, which will be more than enough tonight, or all 13,000 of you, walk out of this event making that decision, no matter what, to believe in the possibility of the God-sized dreams on your heart, to believe in what he says about you, to believe that you can, right? Right? And maybe it means you're gonna walk out of here tonight and you're gonna write the first page of the book, or you're gonna post your poetry online, or you're gonna walk up to a woman out in the lobby and say, do you wanna be friends and expand your friend circle? Or maybe you're getting on the dating app tonight. I don't know what it is. But my hope and prayer is you make the decision to trust him and to believe in the power of the God-sized dreams and anointing he's placed on your heart. I believe in you. I love you. Thank you so much for having me. Thank you.
So good. So good. Wasn't that wonderful? Praise the Lord. How many of you, let's just keep standing for a minute. How many of you have a dream in your heart? Whether it's for your family, whether it's for your finances, a business, better friends like Jamie was talking about. How many of you know that only God can do that? And so tonight I just want to lift you up and just, I want in a minute, I want to sing this song. And what I want you to do is I want you to give it to God right now. I want you to decree that you're not going to give up unless God changes your direction. That if God changes your direction, you're willing. But as long as you have that knowing in your spirit, and God gave you the Holy Spirit. He said, I leave my spirit with you. You have the Holy Spirit of God within you. And I encourage you to call on that spirit. Ask the spirit to reveal to you the secret things of God. The things that you need to do, the people you need to come across, the people that you need to help, the ideas that you need to have. See, the Holy Spirit is there to answer you, comfort you, guide you, lead you. He's there to give you discernment and wisdom. Whatever you need, I want to tell you, the Holy Spirit will give it to you because he promises that he'll give you what you need. So right now, as we begin to sing this song, I want you to give your desires to God, to seek the Holy Spirit for your life. Talk to him every single day. Press into that spirit. Believe that spirit's going to get you to where you need to be. And always give him all the glory and all the honor in Jesus' name. Only God can do that. In the life of the believer. All right, well, I don't really need to introduce the next guest. We all love Sarah Jakes. We love her family. So I just want you to welcome her to the platform right now. Let's give her a warm welcome.
Well, hello, Houston. Hi, guys. Is Jamie Curtin Lima like your best friend in your head or what? Can we just take a minute and honor the gift of Jamie Curtin Lima? That story, you got to pay attention when God exposes you to people's stories, because God's trying to expose you to what's possible for you. So if you thank God that you were exposed to her testimony, can we take a minute and really honor the gift of God that is Jamie Curtin Lima? I don't know. I am a part of Mind Your Business Ministries. Glory, hallelujah, we're international, and hey, child. And I just want you guys to know, Jamie shared it on her Instagram, but she's been going through a really tough season, and she stood here, and she stood tall, and she poured, and she shared, even though her heart was going through, and I just want you to know that you inspired me tonight. Can you help me thank God for Victoria Osteen, please? They don't make them any finer, more classier, more powerful, and anointed than you. Thank you so much for granting me this opportunity. She asked me if I would do this 2 years ago, and I said yes before she could even hit send on the text message, because when Victoria Osteen asks you to do something, you show up. Thank you for this opportunity to serve. Mama Dodie is here. It's like a whole thing. I'm so blessed. My friend Lisa. Okay. I want to do something before you sit down. I know you're tired, you've been at work and you want to sit down, but can we do something real quick? I want you to turn to the woman beside you. Hey girl, how you doing? I want you to, child, what's up? All right, listen. We're going to be very classy because we're at Lakewood. I don't want any cutting up in here. Be very dignified. I want you to turn to the woman beside you and I want you to give her some love. Tell her your hair looks good, your eyebrows are done, you don't look stressed at all. You look like you're in control of what's happening in your world. You look anointed and powerful, like Jesus is your best friend and no one gets on your nerves. You look strong. You look mighty. You look powerful. You look like devils tremble when you wake up in the morning. You look like you've been through hell and came out on the other side. You look like there's glory connected to your life. You look like there's grace connected to everything you've gone through. You look like the enemy meant some things for evil, but God turned it around for good. You look like a testimony. You look like a miracle. Okay. Now I want you to do me a favor. Turn to the woman again. I'm gonna tell you, you already told her she looks good. So now you can follow instructions. I want you to take a minute. I want you to just make eye contact with the woman. Don't say a word. You already told her she looks good. You already asked her where she got her purse from. I set you up. I want you to take a minute. I want you to look at her. And if we can, I want you to look at her in complete silence. I want you to give this woman something she very rarely receives, and that is an opportunity to be seen. The woman you're staring at has dreams inside of her. Some women are nursing heartbreak. Some women in this room are more lonely than they've ever been. And yet tonight, God has made you her partner. God's made you her sister. And whatever happens tonight, it happens with you. I want you to tell that woman, I see you. I love you. I believe in you. You got this. You got this. Don't give up. You're the woman for the job. Tell that woman, girl, get up. All right. Let's go. Husband, my husband's here. Babe, can you do me a favor? Can you let me use your hotspot while my phone, my notes aren't coming up? Wow, that's embarrassing. I wanted to be professional here. Ruth 3. I know my scripture. We'll start with that at Ruth 3. I'm going to start in verse, I love you too. I promise you I do. Ruth 3, verse 14. I want to talk. Okay, y'all, stop now. Come on, man. We can't take you nowhere. Jesus. I'm trying to get invited back, so y'all got to come with me, so you got to act right. Okay, before we dive into the text, I want to give you a little background. I know many of you have heard the story of Ruth, but I never want to take for granted the opportunity that some people don't know every part of the Bible. So I'm going to give you, you got it? Thank you, baby. Oh, you fine and smart. Look what God did with you. Look what God did with you. He was not playing any games. Okay. All right, Ruth. A Moabite woman. She marries a man. The man dies. And she finds herself walking out life with her mother-in-law, Naomi, which is a miracle within itself. If you got a mother-in-law like mine, this would be easy. Some of us, anywho, stay focused. She's here tonight. We can't even talk about it. Um, Ruth makes the decision she's going to walk this thing called life out with Naomi. She has left her country. She has left the gods that she served. She has taken on the God of Israel, the God that we now serve. And she has decided that her next move, her best way forward, is to stay connected with Naomi. We've got two widows trying to figure out what to do next. And when we find them in this text in Ruth 3, I'm going to start in verse 12. Naomi's trying to set her up with Boaz. Boaz is the next kin member who has the ability to marry her and ultimately offer her another chance at life. He is the kinsman redeemer. So when we find her in the text, Naomi has told her to go outside and be fast a little bit. We would call this being fast. But in Hebrew culture, this was appropriate. We would maybe tell her she was out here cutting up, but Naomi gives her a pass. And my text begins after she has stayed the night and she has made herself available, giving him the signal that she is open and prepared for marriage. And my text begins in verse 14. It says, so she lay at his feet until morning. And she arose before one could recognize another. Then he said, do not let it be known that the woman came to the threshing floor. In other words, make this discreet. Also, he said, bring the shawl that is on you and hold it. And when she held it, he measured 6 ephahs of barley and laid it on her. Then she went into the city. When she came to her mother-in-law, she said, is that you, my daughter? Then she told her all that the man had done for her. And she said, these 6 ephahs of barley he gave me, for he said to me, do not go empty-handed to your mother-in-law. Then she said, sit still, my daughter, until you know how the matter will turn out. For the man will not rest until he has concluded the matter this day. Spirit of the living God, we welcome you in this place. Surely you have gathered us here in a space of love, in a space of peace and righteousness, of inspiration, to remind us that you know us, that you see us, that you hold us close to your heart. God, I thank you for every woman, every past, every future, every present represented in this room. God, I thank you that we have the privilege and the honor to be connected with Jesus. And so my prayer is that tonight would be a divine encounter with you and you alone, that you would make this big room feel like a prayer closet between you and her. And as you sit in this room, God, I thank you for great glory. I thank you for peace. I thank you for restoration. I thank you for clarity and vision. Just do that thing that you do when you step into a room. No nerves, no fear, no anxiety, just your voice, your strength standing on the inside of me. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Okay, now you can sit down. I know your feet hurt. Amen. It was three words that started one of the most difficult seasons of my life. Didn't really make any sense. I thought that these three words would inspire me into change and transformation, but these words were the words that revealed to me just how inadequate I was. It was 2 years before the pandemic, and I'd come to a stage in my life where I really wanted to start taking better care of myself. I was in the grocery store minding other people's business. So that's what you go to the grocery store for. I heard the words, I love Orange Theory. Confused me. This woman says, I love Orange Theory. So I make this decision to go and try Orange Theory. This is when I learned that not everyone has the same definition of love. Because there is nothing to really like love about Orange Theory, unless you're her, I guess. I was there and I just wanted to be one of those people who love Orange Theory. So some of you may not even know what Orange Theory is. Orange Theory, it's orange on the inside, similar to the place where Beelzebub resides. And they have like 12 treadmills, 12 row machines and weights. And they want you to spend 55 minutes in Orange Theory so you live right and don't want to go to hell. There's something about the Orange Theory and salvation that has a connection. And every day I went in there and I was hoping to myself, this is going to be the day that I love Orange Theory. And every day I left and I thought to myself, this is not the day that I love Orange Theory. So we're into the pandemic. They shut it down. I'm like, oh God, if it be your will, who am I to stand in the way of what the Lord is doing? They shut it down. I'm halfway through a pan of homemade rolls that I've made, and I'm like, who needs Orange Theory? And then I got on the scale, and it was like, you girl, you need it. It's you, you're the one who needs Orange Theory. And I realized that people don't love Orange Theory necessarily because they love Orange Theory. They love Orange Theory because they know no matter what happens in that room, it's gonna make them better. Like, it may not be something I wanna do. It may hurt in the middle of the process, but I know for sure that it's gonna make me better when I go into that space. And as I was praying about us learning to love our lives, I could not help but consider how many of us sit and wait for a life to love. I'm waiting to fall in love with life. My daughter's 6, she wants to be 13. My daughter's 13, she wants to be 20. When she turns 20, she's gonna realize like bills are gonna make you wanna be 13. I wake up every day and I'm like, Lord, I was rushing to have bills every month. They come every month. You, again, here with me. I think part of the reason why we find it so difficult to love our lives is that we're just waiting for the hard part to be over. It's like, if I can finally get these kids to think straight, if I can finally get the money to go from paycheck to paycheck to actually being able to save, maybe, just maybe, I'll be able to love my life. I'm single, maybe when I get married, I'll love my life. I'm married, maybe when he goes to work, I can love my life for 8 hours. We're looking and waiting for these moments when we will finally love our lives. And so when I was studying about this message and I was asking God, how do we come to a place where we begin to love our lives? God began to show me that it's not so much about us learning to love our lives as much as it is having the mindset, much like we have to have a mindset for things like Orange Theory, that it's not about what's going to happen. It's trusting that whatever happens, it's meant to make me better. That means that even though I may not want to face it, even though it may hurt me in the process, my trust is not in life. My trust is in God. And if God allows for something to show up in my life, it must be here to be a teacher to me. It must be here to refine me. It must be meaning to teach me something. I think Paul would say something like this: for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. There are women in this room who are not just in this room because life went the way that they wanted it to. There are women in this room who became who they are because the suffering taught them something. The suffering taught me to have boundaries. The suffering taught me to be humble. The suffering taught me that if I don't speak up, I'll be ran over. I didn't learn to do this because it was easy. I learned some things because the suffering taught me. The suffering taught me, be careful who you talk about. The suffering taught me, be careful who you let in your life. The suffering taught me that I have an inclination to allow things that are in me to mess up the destiny that God has for me. I didn't just learn this because someone said it. The suffering came and it taught me something. Are there some women in this room who have been taught by suffering? Some people went to school. Other people learned from the suffering. My heart had to break, but I learned a lesson. I got a little sore, but I learned a lesson. The suffering taught me more than the blessings did. We don't like to talk about those things. But there are some lessons that only suffering can teach you. I take better care of the people who are in my life because the grief taught me they're not here forever. I take better care of myself because the heartbreak told me I'll pour and pour and pour until I'm in the hospital. The suffering taught me that there are words that are more powerful than any physical abuse you can ever experience. So I'm careful with my mouth now because someone made me suffer from the words that were on the other side. You want to break a generational curse? It's going to happen because some suffering took place and you decided this suffering cannot pass on to another generation. This suffering cannot live on in my community. I got to break something so the suffering, God, I'm glad that I suffered so that now no one else has to suffer again. See, you got to be a bold girl to say some things like that. But there comes a point where you decide that these scars can work against me or they can work for me. And I have decided that my scars are seed. I'm going to put them in the ground. I'm going to allow the word of God to water them, and I'm going to allow my children to eat from the fruit of the scars that should have took me out of here. Baby, the scars taught me. It wasn't the degree. It wasn't the relationships. I'm not anointed because of who my father is. I'm not anointed because of what I went through. I'm anointed because the suffering made a demand on what God placed on the inside of me. I don't know who you are, but you're going through a suffering season. And I just want you to know from a few of us that there is power on the other side of suffering, that there is breakthrough on the other side of suffering, that there's vision on the other side of suffering. I know your heart is broken, baby girl, but let someone's life be a testimony. Suffering is not the end. If you let it, suffering will be the beginning. Suffering can be the beginning. This pain in your chest, this disappointment, this fear, this anxiety, this suffering, it's not the end of you. It is the beginning. And you're going to learn to love your life, not because everything went well, but because God turned it for good. So I love the one who orchestrated my life. I love the one who planned it. I love the one who understood what was going to happen. So when I'm standing in the moment, I have to love the God who allowed the life. Because sometimes, if we're honest, it's hard to love your life. It's difficult to live in such a way that you experience setback and disappointment and no after no after no. And everyone on the outside looking in feels like, how could you not love your life? You got this, you got that. And you're telling yourself someone else has it way worse, so you just gotta be grateful, you ought to swallow it. But if we're honest, sometimes it's hard. I really wanted to come in here and I wanted to sell you on how easy it is to love your life. But I'm too real with you to let you feel isolated in those moments where it's hard to not love your life. There were some moments when I would pull up to Orange Theory. This is a true story, but I feel like I'm in a safe place. And I would say, not today. I mean, I'm dressed up, I've dropped the kids off, I'm sitting outside, I'm clocked in, but mm-mm. Because I need to know what's gonna happen when I go. Today I'm not in the mood for a surprise. This is not, I'd find myself on Twitter trying to Google what is the workout today. If I'm gonna be on the row machine for 12 minutes, I'm going to the donut shop, which I really need deliverance. Because it's not enough to not work out. Now you got to go eat donuts and not work out, which don't have nothing to do with my sermon. I just want, it's a holy place, and I just felt like I should confess that there are moments where I don't care that it's going to make me better. I just can't pick myself up or convince myself to walk into a circumstance without knowing what's going to happen. I can't afford to not know. I can't afford to live vulnerably. I can't afford to open up. I can't afford to take a chance because I cannot afford to walk away with another heartbreak. I cannot afford to walk away with another pull, another stretch, another tear. There are some moments in our life where we just cannot afford to not know. It's hard to love a life that you don't trust anymore. When I don't trust life anymore, it's difficult for me to show up, and I cannot help but imagine that when we find Ruth in the text, that she's trying to pick up the pieces from a life that is difficult to love. She left her religion. She found someone who she could be in it with. Now that person is gone. The person who made it worth leaving her culture, leaving her society, changing the way that she showed up. Now that person is gone, and she's trying to rebuild and redefine her life. And it is very difficult to rebuild, redefine, and love your life in the middle of it. Maybe that's why some of us are struggling. Because if you're like me, you found yourself in a season where you recognize that this chapter of my life is called the rebuilding. This chapter of my life is called the redefining. And because I don't know what it is becoming, it's difficult for me to love it because I'm afraid of what I'm going to lose in the process. I don't know who I'm going to be on the other side of this. I don't know if I'm still going to have the same joy. I don't know if I'm going to survive with the same openness. I don't know if I'll still have the same creativity, but I'm allowing myself to go through the redefining anyway because obedience is better than sacrifice, or maybe obedience is sacrifice because I have to give up my comfort zone in order to be obedient. And sometimes in church, we make obedience seem like you can do it with confidence. But the truth is, sometimes obedience is sacrifice. Because in order to be obedient, I have to be willing to let go of my idea of what my life should look like. I have to let go of my idea of who my friend should be. I have to let go of my timeline. In order to be obedient, I have to look past my insecurities. I have to look past my anxiety because I have to decide that it is better to be in the will of God than to be in the will of my fear, the will of my shame, the will of my struggles. And so I am obedient even though I am uncomfortable. Ruth is at a moment where her obedience is on the line. And she's rebuilding and redefining this life of hers. And I love so much that when she's in this season of rebuilding and redefining, that God doesn't leave her on her own. Because there are some moments where it is impossible to love the life that is being rebuilt. And so God allows you the opportunity to love the people who are doing the building with you. If I could just take a minute and thank God for the people who God has assigned to be in the rebuilding process with me. God, you could have left me out here by myself. God, you could have made me feel like I was going to be isolated. Some people would be afraid to be in a room with this many people, but I get excited because it lets me know I am not the only one in a rebuilding process. I am not the only one depending on God. I am not the only one standing in a place of faith. God, I thank you that you didn't let me face it on my own. God, I thank you that you made sure that I had at least one person who I could pick up the phone and call. God, I thank you that you sent a message on Instagram in the middle of the night with tears streaming down my eyes. You wanted to make sure I wasn't alone. You're here in this room and you are feeling alone. I want you to understand that is a trick of the enemy trying to make you feel you are alone. Because if you ever got a revelation that you are not the only woman on the battlefield, you would recognize that you got enough backup to make hell nervous. You got enough backup to actually make that generational curse break. You got enough backup in this room, I dare you, to start calling on the name of Jesus. We weren't just singing a song. We were making an army galvanized to put hell on notice that there are some women in Houston, Texas, who have decided that I will not be on the battlefield alone. I may not have every weapon in the book. I may not know every scripture. I may not know what to say when I walk into the room. I may not know how to raise the children. But one thing I do know is that when I call on the name of Jesus, that heaven's angels begin backing me up. One thing I do know is that he'll never leave me nor forsake me. One thing I do know is that no weapon formed against me will prosper. One thing I do know is that weeping may endure for the night, but baby, that sun gotta come up. It's been coming up for
generations after generations. One thing I do know is though he slay me, yet shall I trust in him. I feel like having church on a Friday night at Lakewood. One thing I do know is that we overcame by the blood of the Lamb and the word of the testimony. One thing I do know is one can chase 1,000 and two can chase 10,000, and 13,000 of us could get hell up off of our households. We could get hell up off of our families. One thing I do know is that the Lord wanted you to be in this room so you could see what happens when a warm room full of women decide to go to war with the enemy. I'm sorry I don't have time to play cute with you. I gotta get back home after this. But if I could just push you back into position, you would understand that you are not in the ring on your own. I need you to turn me up in the monitors because hell is about to get it from us tonight. I need you to turn me up in this room because we're going to make sure that the presence of the Lord meets us before we get home. I wish I had a few wailing women in this room who would not mind telling depression to loose my tongue, telling hell to loose my heart. You could have war with me when we get out of here, but for about 30 seconds, I'm going to take a minute and reach up and grab some heaven. I'm going to take a minute and allow the gift of God to be stirred up on the inside of me. I hear God saying, if you let love in, I'll let fight come out. If you let love in, I'll let strength come out. If you let love in, I'll attract who needs to be in your life. I'll subtract what doesn't need to be in your life. I'll show you how to write the book. I'll show you how to build the business. I'll show you how to save the family. You want to love your life? I hear God saying, let me love it first. Let me take care of you. I got you. I got you. We gonna be in this thing until I leave up out of this thing. And when I leave up out of this thing, we gonna pass it to our children to take the ball even further than we took it. We gonna take our mothers with us across the finish line. I'm gonna take my son. You better be careful who you sit next to. You may get pushed into the next dimension. You may be pushed into the finish line. You may start feeling like you could run up on something again. You may start prophesying. You may start speaking in tongues. You may mess around and start having joy even when your life is falling apart because you messed around and got in the right room beside the right woman who made a decision. I'm gonna love my life until it overflows in your life. How could you love that life after all you've been through? I love this life because I'm still here. And if I'm still here, God still got something for me to do. God's still working this thing on out. I don't know how he's gonna do it, but I love it that he's working. I don't know where he's gonna do it, but I know he's on the way. This is how we fight our battles. This is how we get in position. We get together because when we get together, we're stronger than we are apart. Touch that woman beside you, say, you got this. You got this. I believe in you. I'm trusting you. You got this. God's with you. Touch that woman and say, bless her heart. Bless her journey. Bless her past. Bless her future. Bless every dream. Oh God, what is this? Who is that woman you're touching? What has God placed on the inside of her? Why would God assign for you to sit beside that woman lest you have something to impart against her? God, I thank you for what you're going to do in her life. God, I thank you that you're just getting started. God, I thank you for the hedge of protection around her. God, I thank you that depression has got to move out of the way. God, I thank you that anxiety has to bow in the name of Jesus. God, I thank you that fear has no place in her life. God, I thank you that she is more than a conqueror. God, I thank you. Yeah. Faith is coming back. Faith is coming back. Power is coming back. Fill her with the Holy Ghost afresh. Let her burn for you, God. Let her burn like she's never burned before, God. Let it consume her. Let it fill her.
God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah is the highest praise. I'm sorry, I feel like being a church girl and I really wanted to be sophisticated in here, but I call him Jireh because he is a provider. And he doesn't just provide what I think I need. He provides what I didn't even know I needed. I didn't even know I needed to be reminded that I'm not in it on my own. I didn't even know that I needed to know that someone else can go from nothing and turn it into a billion. God, what are you exposing me to? Maybe I'm not crazy after all. God, I didn't even know that you wanted me to be in this room for breakthrough. God, I didn't even know. Glory. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. That you go ahead of us and you make our crooked paths straight. Thank you, Jesus. That you know the end from the beginning. Thank you, Jesus. That while I'm stuck in the middle, you've already gone ahead. I'm sorry, I feel like prophesying. This ain't even in my message. But thank you, Jesus, that you already worked it out. Thank you, Jesus, that they're already talking about me in the room before I get there. Thank you, Jesus, that the child is already saved. God, I know it doesn't look like it right now, but I lay hold and I claim it by faith because I know the God that I serve. And I know that all things can work together for the good of those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. So here I am answering your purpose to prophesy in darkness. Here I am answering your purpose to speak life in a death situation. Here I am answering the call to speak resurrecting power over my mother, resurrecting power over my body. Here I am telling cancer, you gotta go. Here I am telling the prison cells to release my child. Here I am prophesying to the criminal justice system. Here I am building a business without a degree, without the financing, but because I'm answering the call of the Lord that is on my life. Here I am writing a book and healing at the same time. Here I am starting a ministry in the middle of a mess because I'm answering the call. God, I don't know why you'd want to use me, but here I am answering anyway. Because the good is connected to the call. And if you say no to the call, you say no to the good. So if God is calling you to forgive, baby girl, I know they raggedy, I know they don't deserve it, I know they did you dirty, but baby, you got to pick up that phone anyway. God will take care of them, but who's gonna take care of you? Can't nobody give a yes but you. Can't nobody build it but you. Okay. Okay. All right, I'm finished. Y'all can stand, I'm gonna pray. I'm finished, I promise. I just wanna say one thing. Last night I was nervous. I couldn't explain it. I felt anxiety in my chest. I didn't understand it. Then I started thinking about all the reasons I should be nervous and have anxiety, and I said, the math is mathing. I'm not even gonna lie to you. You should be nervous. You got a lot of unknowns. Got a lot of opportunities that are making a demand on a version of you that you don't fully know. You got a lot of responsibility that you aren't sure you can carry. I guess you are nervous. I guess you are anxious. I guess you are afraid to love a life that you could lose. What if I really start loving it and then it's gone, I lose it? What happens if I give my heart to this? If I dare to say, God, I do want the marriage to work. What if I stop acting like I don't care and dare to show up like it really matters to me? And then I end up losing it. I guess you are nervous. And I'm gonna be honest, y'all kind of like are ear hustling off of my, hey guys, ear hustling is like minding my business in my life. Because I said, God, I need a word, and Ruth 3 and 18 came to my spirit, and it simply says, then she said, this is Naomi talking to Ruth, it says, then she said, sit still, my daughter, until you know how the matter will turn out. What I love about this text, I told y'all to stand up, I'm about to pray, look at you, you're just as raggedy as you want to be. Just as disobedient. We done talked about obedience being a sacrifice. I'm just kidding. This text, Naomi tells Ruth, sit still, my daughter, until you know how the matter will turn out. For the man will not rest. The man will not rest until he has concluded the matter this day. That one scripture gave me everything I needed to love the uncertainty of my life in this moment. I don't think that there is anything that keeps us from loving our lives like uncertainty. I do a lot of studying, and I know that Boaz is a type of Christ. When we call him a kinsman redeemer, and Jesus is our ultimate redeemer. In this moment, when I hear he, I'm thinking about Jesus. So when it says, sit still, my daughter, until you know how the matter will turn out, for the man will not rest. The man, Jesus, is not gonna rest until he has concluded the matter that is up in the air for you. It may be up in the air for you. You may have done everything that you know to do. I came to give somebody permission in Houston to sit down and be still, my daughter, because Jesus is going to go ahead of you, and he's not going to rest until he's made sure that every witch, every warlock, every curse, every rumor, every threat, every device of the enemy has gotten out of the way so that you can move forward. I hear God saying that there are some women in this room who have done everything they know to do, and they still don't love their life. And I hear God saying that it is time for you to trust that you can sit down, trust that you did everything you could do, trust that you've said everything that you could say. Now let Jesus step in and do the rest. I hear God saying all you got to do is be. It's not the season for you to do. This is the season for you to be. And if you would just be, then Jesus could do. If you could just be, then God can do. If you do anything else, it's going to be your hands and your miracle. But if you sit down and let God do it, he's going to do what eyes haven't seen. He's going to do what ears haven't heard. He's going to do the foolish things of this world that doesn't even make sense on paper. But he's going to conclude it. God's going to finish this thing. I don't know who started it. Maybe it was you. Maybe it was them. But you gotta accept when you've done everything you can do. And when you have done everything that you can do, you gotta trust that God's gonna do the rest. Some of you are gonna leave here, and you're gonna realize that I haven't done everything I can do. And that's okay too. Get back in the ring. If you're still here, there's still opportunity for you to do everything that you can do. For somebody, it might be therapy. For someone else, it may be forgiveness. For someone else, it may be repentance. For someone else, it may be connecting with someone again. You wanna make sure that you've done all that you can do. And when you have, you gotta trust that God's gonna take care of you. I was reading, okay, now you can play the piano. Can y'all come up here and play the piano so I can? Everything in me wanna ride on that thing up and down like a child. Just next time when I come back. Galatians 2 and 20 says, I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith. In the Son of God, I live by faith. That this is already taken care of, every limitation, every sin, every shame, every scar, I live by faith. That this has already been taken care of by the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Friend, when you don't love your life, and I get it, sometimes it's hard to look at our lives and love it. I know some of us like, Lord, you woke me up this morning, I love that. But sometimes it's hard to look at the disappointment, the heartbreak, the pressure, the infertility, the pain, God. It's hard to love a life that I didn't ask for. I didn't want to be anyone's widow. I didn't want to bury my child. God, this grief, how do I love this life? I want to offer you this piece of hope. I'm not asking you to love your life. I'm loving you to love the life that comes when we are in partnership with Jesus. Because for some crazy reason, Jesus says, I can take your pain, I can take your disappointment, I can take the heartbreak, I can take all the things you love and I can use them and align them and show them to you in a way that I represent them and I give you something to love again. I love this text, I love this story of Ruth because at the end of the day, she was in one of the most tragic seasons of her life. For all purposes, she had no reason to continue loving her life. She left one thing and the next thing that she went to failed. But she stayed in the tension of obedience and uncertainty. And in that tension, God says, I've got a redeemer that's going to pave a way that brings you back to a place of restoration, not just Ruth, but for you. Friend, just stay in the tension of being obedient to who you're supposed to be in God, obedient to taking care of yourself, obedient to seeing your worth and your value. Sometimes I don't believe it, but I'm going to be obedient to what God says. I don't feel fearfully and wonderfully made, but I'm going to carry myself that way because I want to be obedient to what God says. I want to embody what God says about me, even when it's hard for me to believe it myself, because I'm going to do it by faith. And when I do it by faith, I know that the Redeemer is going to help me walk this thing out. And he's going to cause all things to work together for my good. God, I thank you. I thank you for my sisters in this room. I thank you for the grace that's on their lives. God, I want to say a special prayer for every woman living in the pain, the fear, the anxiety, of uncertainty. Who am I now? What is my life now? Can I open up again? God, you know her, you see her, you hear her, she's here. God, I thank you for the woman who's in the most exciting season of her life. And yet she's not sure that she's qualified to keep up. God, I pray that your spirit will begin meeting her right now. Nursing a pregnancy, recovering from an abortion, finally ready to talk about the abuse, finally ready to write the book. God, there are women in this room who are going to be obedient, and it is going to be a sacrifice. It's going to change everything they've ever known about themselves. Somebody's going to go into rehab. Somebody's going to be different in their family. God, I thank you that you're giving this woman strength, I thank you, God, that you're filling her with your spirit. God, I thank you that whether she knew it or not, she accepted Jesus. When she came into this room, she thought she was being curious, but she grabbed onto the hem of his garment. God, I thank you that you're making her hungry for more and more of your presence, God. And I thank you that when she has an encounter with your presence, that you are going to transform her as only you can do. God, I thank you that she's going to be renewed. God, I thank you for resurrection. God, I thank you for reinvention. God, I thank you that one day she's going to look in the mirror and she's going to realize that she doesn't even recognize who's on the other side, but she's thankful that she doesn't recognize her, because she once was lost, but now she's found. God, I thank you that great exploits will be done in your name through her work. God, I thank you that generational curses will be broken as a result of her obedience. God, I thank you that her family will be saved, her community will be changed, the church will be better because she is a part of it, that you're going to teach her how to reach souls, God, and she's going to be the light that we need in this world. God, I thank you that she will establish the kingdom of heaven, and demons will not just tremble, they will scurry and get out of her way. God, I thank you that the doctor's report is wrong. God, I thank you that she's got her head back in the game. God, I thank you that she realizes who her source is, and that rivers of living water are going to flow from her like never before. Certainly you have been with us, and it is clear that you care for us. May this moment not be an ending of a service, but the beginning of a deeper relationship. And let it take root and bear fruit for generations to come. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. That was beautiful. Amazing. Thank you, Sarah. Thank you, Jamie. Thank you, ladies, for coming out and being a part of this night. You know, I do want to just have y'all pause for just a moment. You know, if there's anyone in the room that maybe doesn't know Jesus, or maybe you say, I do want what Sarah's talking about. I know, I want to have the knowing that Jamie's talking about. Maybe you just want to rededicate your life. You're just stirred in your spirit. And you think, God, I need to just confess with my mouth that you're my Lord. I want you to just confess with me right now. Father, I thank you that you have made yourself known to me. I thank you for your son, Jesus, who died for me. And I thank you that when I confess the name of Jesus and I take him as my Lord and my Savior, that everything changes for me. And so, Father, tonight I believe that everything has changed for me. Thank you, Father, for what you've done in me and through me. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You know, if you ever want to talk to anyone, if you want any information about a new walk with Christ, or just any information about a new beginning, you can text LOVE 77377 and we'll get any kind of information to you that you need. We love you. We thank you for being a part of this service. Now, we're going to go out, and there's a dance floor, there's photo booths, there's all kinds of fun. Get together with the girls, have fun, and know that we love you and we thank you for coming out tonight. God bless.